वेलकम टू सिंपल चैनल। इफ यू हैवंट सब्सक्राइब द चैनल प्लीज क्लिक ऑन सब्सक्राइब बटन। इफ यू वांट टू गेट मोर अपडेट्स रिगार्डिंग दिस इंटेक प्लीज क्लिक ऑन द बेल आइकॉन सो दैट यू कैन नेवर मिस एनी नोटिफिकेशन फ्रॉम सिंटेक।
So we are going to use the optim.sgd optimizer to optimize the weights and biases during training. But this time we are going to use a higher learning rate of 10 to the power minus 3. So let's define the optimizer. Note that we need to pass in the model.parameters to the optimizer. And parameters like batch size, learning rate, etc. need to be picked in advance while training the machine learning model. And these are called hyperparameters. Picking the right hyperparameters is critical for training an accurate model within a reasonable amount of time, and it is an active area of research and experimentation. So feel free to try different learning rates and see how it affects the training process. Now that we have defined the data loaders, model, loss function, and optimizer, we are ready to train the model. The training process is almost identical to linear regression. However, we will augment the fit function we defined earlier to evaluate the model's accuracy and loss using the validation set at the end of every epoch. So we begin by defining a function loss batch, which calculates the loss for a batch of data. That's what we are doing here. Optionally, it performs the gradient descent update step if an optimizer is provided, right? So if the optimizer is not none, we compute the gradients, we update the parameters, and then we reset the gradients back to zero. Optionally, it also computes a metric, for example, accuracy, using the predictions and the actual targets. Right? So we are making it generic, so we don't hard code the accuracy metric into the function. Right? So if we pass in a metric function, and if the metric is not none, then we compute the result of that particular metric by passing the predictions and the actual labels. Right? And finally, we return the loss, we return the length of the batch, and we return the metric. The length of the batch is also returned as a part of the result because it will be useful while combining the losses and metrics for the entire dataset, right? So what can happen is that if you have let's say you have a data of size 90 and your batch size is 20, then your last batch is going to be slightly smaller. So if you want to combine the loss and the metric result for all the batches, you're going to need to take into account the size of each batch. Next, we define an evaluate function which calculates the overall loss and a metric if it is provided for the validation set, right? So the evaluate function takes in the model, the loss function, a validation data loader, and a metric, right? And with torch.nograd, since we are not doing this for gradient descent and we don't need to keep track of the gradients or derivatives, we pass each batch through the model. So I'm using a list comprehension here. We get batches of data from the validation data loader, and then we pass them into loss batch. Then, since we get a 3-tuple for each of these results, we can then separate them out into different lists using the zip function. So we get back a list of all the losses, a list of all the batch sizes, and a list of all the metric values. Okay. So the total size of the dataset is simply the sum of all the batch sizes. Then to get the average loss across batches, we multiply the losses with the corresponding batch sizes. We sum up to get the total loss and divide by the total number of elements in the dataset. Similarly, if the metric is available, we calculate an average value of the metric by first multiplying each of the metrics by the particular batch sizes, getting the total and dividing by the total size of the dataset. And finally, we return the average loss, the total size of the dataset, and the average metric. And if it's not immediately clear what this function does, try executing each statement in a separate cell and just look at the results. Next, we also need to redefine the accuracy function we had defined earlier to operate on an entire batch of outputs directly, so that we can use it as a metric in fit. So we take the model outputs and we take the labels, and we use torch.max to simply pick out the index of the output with the maximum value in each row. This gives us the predictions of the model, right? And then we use torch.sum and pass into it preds equal to labels, which returns a tensor of zeros and ones, and toss dot sum then adds them up to give us the total number of correctly predicted labels, and divide them by the length of the predictions, which is the number of elements, to get back the accuracy of the batch. Right, so note that we don't need to apply softmax to the outputs, since softmax doesn't change the relative order of the results, right? So if this is because e power x is an increasing function, that means if a y1 is greater than y2, then e to the power y1 is greater than y2, and then the same holds true after averaging out the values to get the softmax. Okay, so let's see how the model performs on the validation set with the initial set of weights and biases. So I pass in to evaluate the model, the loss function, the validation data loader, and the metric accuracy. This gives me the validation loss. This is the loss averaged over the entire data set. Then it gives me the total length of the validation set, and it gives me the accuracy of the validation set. So once I run this, I need to run this first. So yeah, so now we get back an accuracy of about 10%, and which is what one might expect from a randomly initialized model, since it has a 1 in 10 chance of getting a label right by guessing randomly, right? And also note that we are using the dot format method of the message string here to print only the first 4 digits of after the decimal point. This simply makes it a little easier to look at the result. Right, so we can now define the fit function, which actually performs the gradient descent for a given number of epochs, and we can use the loss batch and evaluate functions internally. Right, so the fit function takes the number of epochs, it takes the model, it takes the loss function, the optimizer, the training and validation data loaders, and optionally a metric. Right, so for it goes into the number of epochs, and then for each in each epoch, we first we train the model. This is simply by getting batches of data from the training data loader and passing them into loss batch. Then we evaluate the model. So we pass in this case we call evaluate, and we pass in the validation data loader. Note that the evaluation is done at the end of every epoch. Right, then we print the progress. So if we have a metric, then we print out the epoch number, the loss, and the metric. Otherwise we simply print out the epoch and the loss, right? And note that you can get the name of the metric function by calling metric dot underscore underscore name. So let us run this. Let's train the model for 5 epochs and take a look at the results. But before I do that, I'm going to redefine the model and the optimizer. This is handy to have it here so that in case I need to reset the model, or I need to encounter some kind of error, I can quickly reinstantiate the model without having to go up all the way. Okay, so now we call the fit function and we pass in all the right parameters, and as you can see, the model training takes a lot longer in this case because we have 60,000 images, each of size 28 by 28, and the matrices, the weight and bias matrices, are also quite large. So now as the model is training, we get back a loss, the loss continues to decrease over time, and the accuracy of the model increases with time. And so that's a great result. With just 5 epochs of training, our model has reached an accuracy of over 80% on the validation set, right? So let's see if we can improve that by training for a few more epochs. So while the accuracy does continue to increase as we train for more epochs, the improvements get smaller with every epoch, right? And I have simply run this for 5 plus 5, 10 epochs here, but you can try running this for a couple more epochs and note down how the accuracy increases. And the increase will actually be easier to see using a line graph, So I have listed out the accuracies here from a previous run. I start with the initial accuracy, which is around 10%, and then I track the accuracy after every epoch. And then I'm using plt.plot to plot the accuracies. I will plot them as a line graph, and I will also mark out the actual points. I'm just going to set some labels here, epoch and accuracy, and finally set a title for the graph. So let me run this. So now you're looking at the accuracy versus number of epochs graph. It's quite clear that from the above picture that the model probably won't cross the accuracy threshold of 90% even after training for a very long time. So one possible reason for this is that the learning rate might be too high. It's possible that the model's parameters are bouncing around the optimal set of weights and biases that have the lowest loss. And you can try reducing the learning rate and training for a few more epochs to see if it helps. But the more likely reason is that the model just isn't powerful enough. If you remember our initial hypothesis, we have assumed that the output, which in this case is the class probabilities, is a linear function of the input, which in this case is the pixel intensities, right? And it is obtained by performing a matrix multiplication of the inputs with the weights matrix and adding the bias. Now, this is a fairly weak assumption, as there may not actually exist a strictly linear relationship between the pixel intensities in an image and the digit it represents. And while it works reasonably well for a simple dataset like MNIST, and it gets us to 85% accuracy, which is not bad, we need more sophisticated models that can capture non-linear relationships between image pixels and labels for more complex tasks like recognizing everyday objects, animals, and so on.